Hello students, this is the sixth lecture of nuclear physics in which I am going to explain to you all about a cyclotron, which is an accelerator, okay, to accelerate the projectiles which are required for artificial transmutation and for the nuclear reactions. Okay, last time when we described the linear accelerator, that time I have just told you why the accelerators are needed. Okay, so this is another type of accelerator that we are going to study today. Now see, the look at the screen, this is cyclotron, and what are the specialities of this cyclotron? In this apparatus, the path described by the charged particle during their acceleration is a series of circles or a spiral, hence it is called as a cyclotron. Okay, so we can see here, in this accelerator, the path described by the charged particle during their acceleration is a series of circles or a spiral. Okay, hence the name is given, that is a cyclotron. Okay, and what was the necessity to describe or to investigate about the cyclotron? It is when in the linear accelerator we have seen the path described by the particle is a straight line, and therefore it has to go through the acceleration many number of times, and therefore the size of the apparatus is very, very large. Okay, so in order to overcome that difficulty, the scientists have developed this kind of the accelerator, where the path described by the charged particle is nothing but a series of circle or a spiral. Okay, that reduces the size of the apparatus. The first cyclotron was developed by Lorentz and Livingston in 1931 at the University of California. The particles undergo circular path due to the magnetic field acting perpendicular to the plane of the apparatus. Okay, so in addition to the electric field, a magnetic field is also applied to the apparatus, as a result of which the path of the particle is turned into a spiral one or a circular one. Okay, because the necessary centripetal force is provided by the force acting due to the magnetic field. It operates on the principle of resonance between the applied electric and the magnetic field. Now, in order to synchronize the electric and magnetic field correctly, there should be a resonance between them. Okay, so it operates on the principle of resonance between the applied electric and the magnetic field. Hence, cyclotron is also called as the magnetic resonance accelerator. So that is another name suitable for the cyclotron. Now, in the construction, we will see the diagram in the next slide. So before that, I'll just explain to you. The cyclotron consists of a flat cylindrical evacuated chamber C, okay, two semicircular hollow metal D's, metal boxes D1 and D2, called as D's, are arranged inside the chamber. An alternating potential of the order of 10,000 volts and of high frequency is applied between the D's. The chamber containing the D's is situated between the pole pieces N and S of a huge electromagnet, so that a strong magnetic field can be established perpendicular to the flat faces of the disc. The source P, which produces positive ions, is situated at the center of the disc. So this positive ion, the source P, we take it as an example. Okay, actually it detects it accelerates any kind of particle. So we are taking the example of the positive ions here. Now this is the diagram. In the diagram you can see, this is the whole thing. You can see this is the chamber C, which is evacuated. Okay, and then inside this you have got two D's. So this is called as a D. So this appears as the letter D, and therefore it is called as a D. So this is called as D1 you have, and the other D, this is the other D, it is called as a D2. Okay, and there is a gap provided between D1 and D2, wherein you keep the source of the positive ions at the center of this. So P is the source of the positive ions. Okay, and then this is the these two D's. D1 is connected to one end of the oscillator, high frequency oscillator. D2 is connected to other end of the high frequency oscillator, which provides the accelerating field, that is the AC field, alternating potential is provided due to this oscillator. It is having a very high frequency as well as the high peak voltage. Okay, and then you have a magnetic field is applied. B is the strength of the magnetic field, which is applied in a direction perpendicular to the screen or perpendicular to the, you can say, paper. Okay, and then you have, there is an exit port by which the particles are coming out of the apparatus, and these particles, they are directed towards the exit pole by a what is called as a deflection plate. Okay, so this is a deflection plate through which it is arriving, it is going out of the apparatus and targeting the given nucleus. Okay, so that is the description of the apparatus. The same, the cross section of this apparatus is shown here. So you have the chamber, this is the chamber C. D1 is, you have one metal D here, so this is D1, the other metal D, D2. At the center of the two, you have the source of the positive ions, and this C is subjected to the two pole pieces of a strong electromagnet, the S pole and the North pole. South pole and the North pole, and this is to the vacuum pump to evacuate this chamber C. Okay, so this is the chamber C. The same is shown here in this particular diagram. Okay, so that is the construction of the cyclotron and the diagram of the cyclotron. Now in working, let us see here how it works. Or we can just read this and again go back to the diagram. Suppose at the instant when the positive ions are produced from D1 has negative potential and D2 has positive potential, the ions are attracted towards D1. Due to the magnetic field acting perpendicular to the plane of the D's, the ions describe a semicircular path inside D1 at a constant speed as there is electric field inside D1. The frequency of the alternating potential and the magnetic field strength are so adjusted that the time required to describe this semicircular path is equal to 1/2 of the period of the alternating potential. When the ions reach the gap between D1 and D2, the potential is reversed so that D1 is positive and D2 is negative. Okay, so you can just see this is exactly same way it works as in the linear accelerator, but only thing is the path is a spiral one because of the magnetic field. Okay, so now you can see at the P, it gives out the positive ions. The moment the positive ions are emitted, now the phase is adjusted. This oscillator D1 is positive, or whichever D is positive at that moment, negative at that moment. So D1 is negative and D2 is positive. So ions are positive, they get attracted towards the negative D or the negative electrode. So as they just go inside, what happens? They are subjected to the magnetic field, and therefore their path is nothing but a spiral. So they cover this particular path, okay, and they come at the gap again. So when the moment they come at the gap, what happens? The phase reversal takes place. Okay, so D2 becomes negative and D1 becomes positive. When D2 becomes negative, these particles at the gap, they get attracted towards D2. Okay, now in doing so, in the gap, they gain the energy, which is provided due to the accelerating potential. Okay, so as they gain energy, now naturally the speed of the particle increases. As the speed of the particle increases, the radius also increases. So you can see in the diagram, they cover a spiral of larger radius, correct? They cover the spiral of larger radius. Now they when arrive at the gap again, what happens? The phase reversal takes place. Then D1 becomes negative, D2 becomes positive. So these are again further accelerated in the gap. They get attracted towards D1 again. Okay. But now again the speed of the particle increases, the radius of the particle increases. Okay, so they come at the gap, again the phase reversal takes place, and etc. The process continues. So you can see here the particle undergoes the spiral of more and more radius with more and more velocity. After gaining sufficient kinetic energy, they are deflected to the exit port and they are bombarded on the target. Correct? So that is the action, or that is the working of this particular, say, cyclotron. So now the same thing is written in this. The positive ions are accelerated towards D2 and describe a semicircular path of larger radius. The speed of the ions inside D2 is constant but greater than their previous speed inside D1. Again, when the ions reach the edges of D2, the potential is reversed so that D2 will be positive, D1 negative. The positive ions again accelerated towards D1 and move with still faster speed inside D1 along a semicircular path of greater radius. This process continues. Every time the ions cross the gap, what happens? They get an additional energy. After number of revolutions, when the ions come near the periphery of the D's with the maximum speed, they are brought out of the D's by a deflecting plate and strike the target. Okay, so that is the working or action of the cyclotron. Now looking at the theory part of this, let us see how you can explain this theory of this. Now the force experienced by the charged particle in the magnetic field of strength B is given by what? F is equal to B, the strength of the field, E, the charge of the particle, and V is the velocity of the particle. Okay, where is the charge and V is the velocity of the particle. So due to this force, the particle undergoes a circular path of radius r. Okay, so for the first orbit you have BEV1. V1 is the speed of the particle in the first orbit, is equal to what is the centripetal force. Now to undergo a spiral or a circular path, the particle needs a centripetal force, and that centripetal force is provided by the magnetic field, or the force due to the magnetic field. So what is the centripetal force given by mv? Mv square upon r is the centripetal force. So for the first spiral you have m into v1 square divided by r1. Okay, so from this you can calculate what is the radius of the first spiral. So that is mv1 divided by b. So call this as equation number 1. Similarly for the second spiral or second orbit, r2 is equal to what? mv2 divided by BE, that is your equation number 2. Now thus the particle continues to travel in a semicircular path of increasing radius from one D to another D with greater and greater speed. Time taken by the particle to travel a semicircular path of radius r1 in the first orbit is given by what? T1 equal to pi r1 divided by v1. So this again from our equation, time is equal to distance traveled divided by speed. Now what is the distance traveled by the particle? Distance traveled by the particle is a semicircular distance of radius r1. Okay, so for one complete circular say distance, that is the circumference of the circle of radius, you have the distance travel is 2 pi r. All of you know mathematically. So for the semicircle it is 2 pi r divided by 2, that is nothing but the pi r1. So t1 equal to the distance traveled by the particle for the in this first spiral is pi r1 divided by v1. So pi upon v1 into, if we just substitute from our equation 1 for r1, mv1 divided by b. So t1 becomes equal to pi m upon b. That call this as equation number 3. Similarly, time taken by the particle to travel semicircular path of radius r2 is equal to what? T2 equal to pi r2 divided by v2, that is pi m upon b. This is your equation number 4. Okay, so what you learn from equation 3 and equation 4? Hence time is what? time is independent of R and V. Okay, so it is clear that the ions will arrive each time at the gap between the D's exactly at the same moment when the alternating potential can accelerate it further, means when the phase reversal takes place. Okay, for each complete turn of the spiral, the ions gain energy equal to twice the tension applied between the D's. So what is the total energy with which the ions will emerge is given by E equal to 2N into V, where N is the number of revolutions, complete final number of revolutions, and V is the peak value of the alternating potential. Now we can find out what is the expression for frequency of rotation of the particle. The time taken by the ion to complete a semicircular path is given by T equal to pi m upon P e. So that we have seen, and we have also seen that it is independent of the radius as well as the velocity of the particle. So pi is a constant, m the mass of the particle is a constant, b the magnetic field strength is a constant, e the charge of the particle is also constant. Okay, so this time, this must be equal to what? 1/2 of the period of the applied alternating potential. Okay, so what is that? So T becomes equal to pi m upon b e. That must be equal to T by 2, where T, capital T, is what? The periodic time of the high frequency oscillator. Or that is equal to 1 upon 2F, where F is the frequency of the applied alternating potential. Now, therefore, F becomes equal to, you simplify this equation for F, BE divided by 2 pi M. This is your equation 6. The particles exhibit spiral path many times with increasing speed. At every stage, they gain more and more energy. The maximum energy is attained at the last orbit, and then they are bombarded to the target by a deflecting electron. Okay, so that is the theory behind it. Now this frequency, okay, the frequency of the alternating potential must be equal to the frequency of the revolutions of the particle. Okay, so these two frequencies, they resonate, and therefore you have every time the particle arrives at the gap at the same moment the phase reversal takes place, and therefore it can accelerate it further. Okay, so that is the resonance is very, very important between the frequency of the particle and the frequency of the external source here. Then we can also find out what is the expression for the maximum energy. So E max equal to 1/2 m v n square. Okay, Vn is what? The velocity at the nth revolution. So Vn equal to, from equation number 4 we can calculate, Be Rn divided by m, equation 7. So we can substitute this value in place of Vn square. So E max equal to B square, E square, Rn square divided by 2m. This is your equation number 8. Now we can find out what are the energies, maximum energy that you get by the different particle. So a cyclotron can accelerate a proton with maximum energy of 40 MeV and deuteron with 20 MeV. A cyclotron cannot be used to accelerate electron even up to 1 MeV, because at 1 MeV the speed of the electron is 0.9 times c, very nearly equal to the velocity of light, and its relativistic mass becomes 2.5 times its rest mass. So that's the difficulty that we observe in case of a cyclotron. Let's see how, what is the relativistic effect on the limit of energy. Okay, now there is a limit for the energy for the relativistic particle. Okay, so what are the relativistic particles? The relativistic particles are those whose velocities are very nearly equal to the velocity of light. Okay, so for the relativistic particle, variation according to the variation of mass, which we have seen in relativity, with velocity, the mass of the particle moving with velocity v is given by m equal to m naught into square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. So when v is very nearly equal to c, what happens? This ratio v square upon c square is nearly equal to 1. So you have m naught upon this factor, v square upon c square. Okay, so this is a fraction. So m increases as the velocity v increases. Hence, for relativistic particle, mass increases with velocity. So from equation 5, the increase in mass produces increase in the value of T. Correct? So as the mass increases, pi m upon b. So as the mass increases, the time also increases. Hence the particle takes more time to complete the semicircular path and may reach the gap between the d's a little late. This keeps the arrival of the particle out of step with the period of the applied field. So in that case, the frequency of the applied source and the frequency of the particle, they don't match. And if they don't match, the further acceleration is not possible. Hence, there is a limit for the maximum energy in case of the relativistic particles. For the heavy particles, the mass increase is not that much, and therefore, whatever the increase in mass can be neglected. But for relativistic particle, there is a limit for the maximum energy. And how you can solve this problem? So you can solve this problem by the applying or by the finding the synchrocyclotron or frequency modulated cyclotron. To overcome the limitations of the cyclotron, two methods can be used. What is the first method? Under the fixed value of frequency of an alternating potential, the magnetic field B is increased gradually along with the increase in mass of the particle, so that B by M remains constant in the equation F equal to BE upon 2 pi M. Okay, so corresponding to the B, M, as M increases, B also changes. Okay, so that B by M remains constant. Okay, when B by M remains constant, the frequency will become constant. Such a device is called as a synchrocyclotron, in which B by M remains constant. Then another one is the frequency modulated cyclotron. So under constant magnetic field, the frequency of the alternating potential is decreased as M increases in accordance with the equation F equal to BE upon 2 pi. So as M increases, the frequency of the particle decreases. So as the frequency of the particle decreases, the external source, the frequency is also modulated, or it is adjusted, tuned to the frequency of the particle. Okay, and therefore this, as it is tuned to the frequency of the particle, the particles will arrive at the gap at the same moment when the phase reversal takes place, and the acceleration further is possible. Such a device is called as a frequency modulated cyclotron. Okay, so this problem of say relativistic variation of mass with velocity, and due to which the frequency not matching with the frequency of the external source, it can be overcome by synchrocyclotron or frequency modulated cyclotron. Okay, so that is all about the principle construction working of the cyclotron and the advantages disadvantages of the cyclotron. In the next class, we are going to learn about the another instrument, which is a detector, which is called as a GM counter. Okay, so we will take this in the next class. So we'll stop here.